The secrets of ancient medicine have remained impenetrable for thousands of years. But now they are being rediscovered. Buried within forgotten texts lie accounts of shocking, gruesome treatments. How did Incan surgeons drill through the human skull to save patients from certain death? How did a fish with the power of a taser gun cure pain? An extraordinary surgical tool used to operate on a prince with one of the strangest head wounds in history. Ancient Discoveries is entering a remarkable world of snakes, leeches, and death rays, uncovering a secret. They all worked. This is the untold story of gruesome medicine. Bloodletting. The very word conjures images of cruelty and sacrifice. Beginning over 3,000 years ago, patients were bled to death in their thousands. Ancient doctors removed up to 4 pints in a bid to cure everything from fever to madness.
It does sound outrageous to open the veins and drain somebody of their life-giving fluid, but in some circumstances it can actually be beneficial.
Bloodletting's most famous practitioner hailed from ancient Greece, and his name was Galen. Born in 129 AD, he was to become worshipped as a god for his miraculous healing powers.
Galen had a theory of medicine that was based on balancing humors throughout the body. And he assumed that in order to get the right balance of humors, if you let out blood, then the humors balance themselves.
A chilling array of tools were used to open up his patients, from hooks and scalpels to knives and cutting machines. The most notorious of all was the leech.
I think most patients today, seeing leeches on their body, would throw up their hands in horror, as it being an outmoded form of treatment. But it has undergone a resurgence.
Galen's theories, along with the use of leeches, have been dismissed for centuries. But now, recent evidence has caused medical science to reevaluate them. At the Ancient Discoveries Laboratory, leeches expert Carl Peters is investigating the leeches' blood-sucking powers.
In this small vial here, we have just some ordinary sheep's blood, and on the bottom we have some collagen membrane. So we'll put the leech on the bottom there, and then hopefully it'll drain the vial.
Over 20 minutes, the leech sucks the blood from the vial, multiplying its body weight by up to 4 times. The question remains, how could this phenomenal sucking power be used to save lives? For a window into how ancient leechcraft worked, Ancient Discoveries has brought in a human guinea pig, former military officer David Shaw. Dave is about to feed these miniature carnivores with their food supply for the next 6 months.
I'm not a fan of needles at the best of times, and the leech is like a little biological needle, I suppose, but he's got about 300 teeth, or so they tell me. So yeah, a little bit anxious, a little bit nervous.
Carl attaches the leech to Dave's calf. It begins by flexing to increase body volume and prepare for drinking up to 50 milliliters of human blood. After 25 seconds, the leech breaks the skin.
When it makes the hole, it bites in. It's got three jaws, 125 teeth on each jaw.
Normally, when the skin's surface is broken, a blood clot forms to prevent us from bleeding to death. Here we see the leech's 3 jaws. Leeches have a unique substance that overrides the body's clotting mechanism, their saliva. This acts as an anticoagulant, which prevents the blood from clotting. In the ancients' procedure, as now, the leech falls off once it's had its fill of approximately 2 ounces of blood.
It was quite an experience. it surprised me the number of times that he actually felt a little sharp prick, and apparently the leech is not happy with just one bite of the cherry. He likes to dig a bit deeper and find the optimum blood supply. You could feel the bodily contractions of the leech as he kind of ingested the blood, but you couldn't feel a flow.
Now begins the second part of the ancient procedure. Most of the blood wasn't removed by the leech itself, but from the unclotted bleeding caused by the leech's saliva.
Once the leech feeds, because of the anticoagulant in the area, it'll sort of help the area decongest, and the hole it makes will still bleed for about 10 hours. So you've got the blood into the artery and out to the hole the leech is made. So it's keeping the area alive long enough for the body to repair.
These limbs are suffering from a septic necrosis, which is caused by a lack of blood supply and bone death, a condition seen on the battlefields of ancient Greece due to sword and axe wounds. As the blood vessels are severed, limbs are deprived of critical nutrients in the blood, resulting in amputation or death. The leech's saliva contains agents that vasodilate the small veins and capillaries in the flesh. This allowed ancient leeches to draw the blood evenly through damaged flesh, keeping it alive while it healed. Yet leeches were not the only skin-crawling critter to inhabit the world of ancient gruesome medicine. The most shocking treatments of all came from poisonous snakes. In Greece lies the ruins of Epidaurus, headquarters of a mysterious ancient snake cult said to have magical healing powers. It was founded in 300 BC by a demigod whose name was Asclepius.
The cult of Asclepius was very important in ancient Greece, and people would flock from all over Europe to visit him and to receive his wisdom and his healing and his diagnostic powers.
Asclepius's symbol of healing was a snake.
There is the fable of the snake bringing the herbs of life, and it is thought that his symbol of the staff with the single snake coiled round it arises from that story.
Asclepius's snake potions were said to have the power to revive the dead. For 2,300 years, they have been dismissed as myth. Now, modern science may provide clues as to how the snake potion worked. The Liverpool School of Tropical Medicine in England houses over 200 of the world's most poisonous snakes. Dr. Rob Harrison is one of the foremost experts on the medical effects of snake venom. In order to make a snake potion, the ancients would have needed to milk the venom. Our subject is the horned viper, one of the most dangerous snakes in the world.
Venom extraction is a dangerous procedure. It should only be done by experts. It's important when I'm helping Paul milking the snakes that we're not scared, but that we feel competent. Anxious is all right, scared is not all right.
The horned viper is native to northern Africa, and just half of its maximum dose is enough to kill an adult.
If a person was bitten, they could be in a life-threatening situation within 20 minutes, half an hour.
Okay, Paul, are you ready for the next round?
Ready.
As Dr. Harrison and his snake handler, Paul, extract the poison, they are replicating a process carried out by the ancient snake handlers.
You got the green one?
I've got the green.
Okay, good. Thanks.
Yeah.
Ready?
Once the snake is trapped, the handlers place its jaws over the edge of a beaker and force the venom into the beaker's bottom. Modern research supports the idea that a snake potion would have had certain benefits. The neurotoxins can be used to create drugs that treat Alzheimer's and memory loss, and its hemotoxins help combat heart disease and high blood pressure.
125,000 people die every year from snake bite. High blood pressure certainly kills many more people than that. And the ACE inhibitors, which are the most effective drug against high blood pressure, were developed from snake venom proteins. So we should look at snakes not just as enemies, but also as potential contributors to our better health.
If the ancients did access the same unique properties of snakes as modern medicine, how did they ingest the venom in the first place? Amazingly, they may have drank it. Drinking lethal snake venom is not fatal, unless there are cuts in the digestive system allowing the venom access to the bloodstream. 2,300-year-old accounts tell of Asclepius's patients drinking from the head of a snake-covered gorgon, and then developing the power to heal. Tantalizing evidence that the ancient Greeks could have discovered the same healing powers as the 21st century's latest medical drugs. The ancients' unrelenting search for new medical treatments even saw them transform an underwater killer's taser-like weapon into a miracle cure. The secrets had been lost to time. Until now. Since the beginning of history, humans have sought to manipulate and control pain. From ancient torture devices that inflict unimaginable suffering to magical ointments that make pain disappear.
The fact that we want to get rid of pain is not new. I'm sure the Romans, the Greeks, the Egyptians, and probably everybody who went there before them didn't want pain either.
Today, when we think of pain relievers, we think of aspirins or morphine. But in 100 AD, the Romans discovered a very different solution to pain relief. A secret lost to history that depended on a terrifying denizen of the deep. Roman historian Plutarch left an account describing an incredible pain neutralizer, a rare kind of electric eel known as a torpedo.
The ancient Roman sources describe how sufferers of extreme joint and leg pain were taken down to the beach. Here, their feet were placed directly on top of the torpedo. After time, their suffering abated and their pain disappeared.
The Roman accounts tell of how the torpedo could be used to cure almost all pains, from stomach cramps to syphilis. But aside from the basic ancient descriptions, nothing is known about how the treatment actually worked. How does the jolt of a dangerous animal relieve pain? At the Finisterre Aquarium in La Coruña, Spain, torpedoes are being scientifically examined for the first time. Fernanda Miguelis is a marine scientist who has long been fascinated by the fish whose deadly electric shock weapon may have the power to heal.
It's a fish that has remained mysterious for centuries because it primarily lives undercover on sandy beds, hidden from human eyes. The torpedo's electric discharge is primarily for defense, but it is also used to kill prey. When in an attack mode, the torpedo electrocutes its target fish, paralyzing it before swallowing it whole.
To unravel the mysteries of the torpedo, the fish's deadly electric charge must first be quantified using the latest scientific techniques. To do this, the team need to move the torpedo to the laboratory's test center. Two millennia after the Romans discovered the torpedo's electric powers, modern science can now reveal how the electricity is produced. Two electric organs, each containing over 1,000 cells, form the torpedo's electrical power station. When the torpedo stings, the brain signals for the cells to fire, and an electrical charge is produced.
Each of the cells produces a small quantity of electricity, but the combination of many cells, all acting in unity, generates an exceptionally powerful electrical discharge.
The result is a living aquatic taser.
This machine here is an oscilloscope. We use it to measure the torpedo's electric discharge. It measures the voltage of the charge in relation to time. Today, we are going to measure the highest electric charge that it is possible for the torpedo to produce.
Torpedo is Latin for paralyzed, so Fernanda must take great care when handling the fish during the test. The torpedo fires its electric bolt, which registers at 20 volts, almost twice the shock level from a modern car battery.
Look, look here. There is a signal of 20 volts, firing three times at intervals of only 5 milliseconds. This would cause a severe pain if inflicted upon a person.
The Ancient Discoveries team now have a solid reading of the torpedo's electric potential. But the vital question remains, how did the Romans transform an aquatic taser weapon into an anesthetic? At the Ancient Discoveries Pain Lab, Dr. Watson is about to test how Plutarch's astonishing 2,000-year-old pain reliever actually relieves pain. And for that, we need someone in pain. David Shaw has returned to put his body on the line for another daredevil ancient experiment.
We're going to measure how tolerant Dave is of pain.
Dr. Watson places Dave's finger in a device called an algometer. This will push him to the limit of pain endurance by squeezing his finger until he can bear it no longer.
I'm going to put your finger in here, and I'm going to keep squeezing, and I'm going to keep applying pressure until you tell me to stop. It's going to hurt, so give me a finger. I'm going to start applying the pressure, and I'm going to squeeze and squeeze and squeeze.
As Dr. Watson cranks up the pressure on Dave's finger, neurotransmitters shoot up through the nervous system at 300 feet per second to deliver pain messages to the brain. At this rate, his brain is experiencing pain signals commensurate with a second-degree burn.
Go on, keep going, keep going, keep going. And enough.
A bit more. Ooh, that'll do, that'll do, that'll do.
Well, Dave, that was 827. Well, 827 is not too bad. That's certainly higher than average. And but then, given your background and your exposure to pain in the past, then I'd expect you to be higher than average.
Oh.
Dave's reading reveals he is able to withstand 827 kilopascals of pressure, equivalent to having a 700-pound person standing on his finger.
It's kind of an all-encompassing pain that you can't really escape from. Certainly wouldn't want to be in that kind of pain if it was a continual, just a 24/7. You'd be looking for something, anything, to relieve the pain, especially if it was as intense as I've just experienced.
Now, the way we think the torpedo worked is that it produced enough electrical charge to theoretically numb pain by neutralizing the nerve impulses sending messages to the brain. So Dr. Watson matches the number of volts produced by the torpedo and administers that to our patient.
We're going to be using an electrical stimulator that delivers a particular kind of current. It's really just a modern version of what the Romans were doing with their torpedo fish. Okay, Dave, so what we've done is we put a couple of fairly big electrodes here. I'm just going to turn this up really slowly.
The electrical current is almost identical to the 20-volt reading from the torpedo. If the ancient accounts are correct, in his electrically numbed state, Dave should now be able to increase his pain score of 827 kilopascals.
How it works is this. There's a gate in the spinal cord which controls how much pain does and doesn't get through. We are simply using electricity to make the nerve fire. The stimulation of this nerve is going to shut the pain gate, and effectively we're going to reduce the ability of the body to transmit pain from the hand up to his brain. And if the pain starts in his hand but doesn't reach his brain, he can't feel it, and therefore he will feel less pain.
Now, Dr. Watson must test whether the electrotherapy theory works in practice. After 15 minutes of electrical stimulation at 20 volts, Dr. Watson cranks up the pinometer for the second time. The pinometer crunches Dave's finger into 1/4 of an inch. He is now experiencing a far greater level of pain than we would expect a human to be able to take.
Yep.
Okay. So that gives us 1096. That's
1096.
That's different from last time. Very
so
different.
200 up.
200 up. That's about 25% up on where we were before. Originally, he was feeling 827. That's when he told me to stop. This time, we got up to 1096, 1,096 before he told me to stop. So I've made him less able to feel pain.
Dave can now withstand pressure equivalent to being run over by a 2-ton truck. 2,000 years after Plutarch's first accounts, this pioneering experiment has revealed that the stories of the ancient Romans' miracle cure are grounded in fact.
I'm pretty sure they didn't understand about pain gates in the spinal cord, and I'm pretty sure they didn't understand about stimulating nerves in order to get pain relief, but they knew that using electricity, which happened to come from a torpedo fish, produced the sensation of pain relief. Thousands of years later, our modern machines are just an up-to-date way of doing torpedo fish therapy.
Even the Romans might wince at some of the treatments in the mysterious world of the Incas. Here, doctors literally cut open the human head. In Cusco, Peru, in the remote reaches of the Andes, a cache of over 500 Incan skulls has been discovered. Over half bear signs of terrible, seemingly impossible injuries. Circular wounds in the skull up to 3 inches across. Too precise to be inflicted by any known weapon. Evidence of an ancient, gruesome practice. Inca historian Peter Frost is investigating the mythical world of the Incas.
The mystery of the Incas comes from the fact that they were a civilization that grew up in isolation from the rest of the world. There wasn't any contact with them, and they didn't have a written language.
The skulls were found in a region known as the Sacred Valley, home to the magnificent lost city of Machu Picchu. Founded in the year 1450, the city lies at almost 8,000 feet above sea level. Surrounded by cliffs and continually wreathed in cloud, this was the secretive citadel of a civilization that ruled over 1 million square miles and 10 million people. Yet the Incas lived here for just 100 years, sucking the mystery of the Incan skulls into the mists of time. 5 centuries later, new forensic evidence may yet solve the riddle. It suggests that the people survived their injuries.
There are lots of examples of skulls that they've unearthed, which show that the skulls began to grow back over the wound.
The linchpins of Incan warfare were weapons such as the club or mace, weapons that deliver severe trauma injuries, such as a fracture to the skull.
The thing about a skull injury or a skull fracture, a depression fracture, is that it pushes bone fragments into the brain area, and they must be elevated or taken away, because of course the skull is a box. And if the box is closed and there's bleeding inside the brain, then pressure increases and eventually the brain must die.
Incan surgeons developed an astonishing solution to this seemingly fatal injury.
They did develop one technique which is extraordinarily sophisticated, which is skull trepanation.
Trepanation is the removal of an area of the skull to release pressure or to decompress a depressed fracture of the skull.
We can tell how long an Inca lived after the procedure by analyzing the skulls to see if they show signs of healing. Amazingly, in 80% of the observed cases, the Incas survived this early form of brain surgery. But how? At the Ancient Discoveries Laboratory, leading surgeon Mike Edwards is taking a journey back through 600 years of history. He is carrying out a trepanation using Incan tools on the head of a dead sheep, purchased from a butcher shop.
The challenges involved in performing a trepanning in Incan times must have been tremendous. Let's imagine that I'm sitting on some Peruvian hillside with this chap's head between my knees, and I've taken the hair away by shaving, and I'm just making my first incision.
Mike will use the same blade as the Incan surgeons, a form of volcanic glass called obsidian, which is 5 times sharper than surgical steel. Keep in mind, the Inca patient would not have been anesthetized.
It's a tense time because I know it's going to hurt the guy that I'm operating on, but yet I have to keep my nerve. I mustn't be put off by his screams, and my hand mustn't shake. and I've got to know what I'm doing is going to benefit him. It's the same for any surgical procedure, apart from the fact, in this case, my patient's wide awake and feeling what I'm doing. The obsidian blade went through the scalp in one fluid move, so it's an incredibly sharp instrument.
It takes Mike about 30 minutes to cut through the bone. Not long, unless you're an Inca patient. During the operation, Mike lacerates several cranial nerves, sending extreme pain messages instantaneously to the brain. Beneath the bone lies the dura, a thin layer embedded with blood vessels. It is the body's final layer protecting the brain, but it has the consistency of a cotton shirt.
I'm very careful as I go through the skull not to damage the dura, because I know if I pierce the dura, it's going to bleed, and I may not be able to control the bleeding. I will also enter the brain tissue. It may be that there's pressure inside the brain that has caused me to be doing this procedure in the first place. So if I pierce the dura, there's every chance that the brain may just burst through like toothpaste and just come out in front of me, and the patient will die within seconds. Well, looking at this, I think this has been a successful trepanning. We've made the skin flap that you see here. We've gone through the periosteum, we've gone through the bone, and this, peeping up at us through this hole here, is the dura.
The vast majority of patients were killed not by the trepanning, but by infection of the brain afterwards. But 8 out of 10 Incan patients survived. The bone reformed over the hole and the skin healed, leaving nothing behind but a small indentation. In the same time period, over 6,000 miles away in England, a simple blacksmith set about transforming medical history. How did he use nothing more than a hammer and molten metal to perform brain surgery needed to remove an arrow that had been shot straight through the head of the most powerful prince in the medieval world? The ultimate test center for medicine is the theater of war. Yet few today realize that the surgical techniques deployed in war zones from Vietnam to Iraq were invented over 2 millennia ago in Imperial Rome. The Roman drive for military might saw the creation of the Medici, the first medical army elite in history.
The medics became very much more important and significant as the Roman army became professionalized. And this was around the first century AD by Emperor Augustus, who recognized the importance of having a quality medical support team for his forces, for his armies.
Preserved at the Museum of Roman Civilization in Rome lies an intriguing collection of images taken from Trajan's column and dating from the year 113 AD. They depict surgeons operating on the front lines, applying bandages, splints, and emergency first aid. If the reliefs are accurate, they show that the Roman surgeons pioneered the tools and techniques used by today's military medics. Leading surgeon Damien Mole is investigating.
The basic principles behind surgery and surgical operations have changed little throughout the ages, even though the technology has. A battlefield surgeon would be interested in stopping blood or needing to perform an emergency amputation. He would have needed something to cut skin, muscle, tendon, which would be a knife, and he would have needed something to cut bone, which would have been a saw. This saw is still used by many, many operators to cut through bone during an amputation.
An extraordinary account left in a second century text by a Roman surgeon named Celsus describes an early use of scalpels, hooks, and clamps. Amazingly, its instructions are still obeyed in operating theaters today. Modern surgeons clean and stitch up wounds just as he recommended over 1800 years before.
Only a foolish surgeon would ever ignore history and ignore the past. The kind of clamps and that were used in Roman times are similar to the ones used today. There have been developments in the materials and obviously in the design of the clamps, but the principle of applying them and the mechanics used of the instrument to stop blood flow would have almost certainly been identical.
Celsus's four sins of inflammation, redness, heat, pain, and swelling, are still memorized by every modern surgeon. This patient will later make a full recovery, a recovery founded on Rome's battlefield medics. Yet throughout history, survival depends not just on battlefield innovation, but also on rank and influence. The need to save wounded generals, commanders, kings, and even emperors has driven medicine to astonishing new heights. In the year 1403, Prince Hal, heir to the English throne, led 4,000 troops against an uprising that would become...
And the word tonight is UNIVAC, the giant brain made only by Remington Rand. It's the first electronic computing system to be proven by widespread use. Because of its exclusive self-checking features, UNIVAC cannot make a mistake. That's why the United States government, General Electric, U.S. Steel, Metropolitan Life, and DuPont have selected UNIVAC, the world's first electronic computer practical for commercial use. A product of Remington Rand, famous too for the Remington, the world's number
Battle
one...
of Shrewsbury. He was aged just 16, and within 24 hours, his face would never be the same again.
As the Royal Army advanced, the archers on the top of the hillside sent this hail of arrows down the hill, and contemporaries, when they've experienced a battle like this, all talk about how the sky literally darkens over because of the sheer number of arrows that come flying down through the sky. Now, if you're a knight and you're wearing full plate armor, it gets increasingly difficult to breathe. So as they're staggering up this hillside, the first thing they all do is throw back their visors, and that makes them immediately vulnerable to the arrows because their faces are lifted, and so that's exactly what happened to Henry V.
Prince Hal was struck by an arrow just beneath his left eye. It penetrated 6 inches into the skull, leaving the prince fighting for his life.
The extraordinary thing about Battle of Shrewsbury is not just that Henry V got hit by this arrow, but that he didn't leave. He stayed on and he fought. This wretched arrow stuck in his face.
At the Glasgow Digital Design Studio in Scotland, eminent neurosurgeon Ian Saban has for the first time recreated this wound on a virtual Prince Hal.
The arrowhead involved was a bodkin, which was designed to be armor-piercing, and as such would have punched its way through the tissues, almost surgically. Potentially, structures that were damaged include a nerve that exits just under the eye, called the infraorbital nerve, which gives feeling to the cheek, which would have left him with a numb cheek. It would then have penetrated the thin bone of the maxillary air sinus, which is an air-filled cavity within the skull, and punched its way through the nose before ending up in this area, close to the jawbone or mandible, and very close to the carotid arteries.
At a scale of over 1,000%, Ian is now able to map in three dimensions how perilously close the prince came to death.
So if we now remove the facial skeleton to show the arrow track more clearly, we can see just how close potentially it came to structures that would have led to fairly rapid death. The jugular vein, the main draining vein from the brain, and the carotid arteries, the main arteries leading to the brain and to the facial muscles. In addition, very close also is the spinal cord and the brainstem, injury to which would have been instantly fatal.
The prince was taken to Kenilworth Castle in the heart of England. Its ghostly remains still stand. His attendants carefully tried to remove the arrow, but then, disaster. The arrow breaks. Now the prince has a bodkin arrowhead lodged 6 inches inside his skull. How will they get it out? And who in all the kingdom has the skill to do it? The prince's advisors chose John Bradmore, a surgeon, locksmith, and convicted coin forger, for the challenge of a lifetime.
You've got to imagine that Bradmore was in a unique situation. For the start, that he was in prison for counterfeiting, which was quite a serious offence, and he had been dragged out of prison, brought up to Kenilworth and said, right, here's the situation, you've got the future King of England, he's got an arrowhead in his head, we want you to get it out.
Just hours out of prison, John Bradmore hatched an incredible plan. he decided to forge a new surgical instrument armed with nothing but a hammer and several sheets of molten metal. Historical blacksmith Hector Cole is reconstructing John Bradmore's arrow extractor using the same techniques Bradmore himself would have used over 600 years earlier.
What John Bradmore would have had to have done first would to forge out the strip of metal to make the main body of the extractor. And I've done that, and I've thinned out the two ends so that they are the right thickness to be able to put the flutes in to make it into a half a cylinder at each end. Because when the two come together, they make a complete tube to enter the wound where the arrow went into Prince Henry's head.
While John Bradmore worked, hour by hour, fever and infection pushed the prince ever closer to death.
Time was of the essence, obviously, and he didn't have a lot of time to make it. He would have had perhaps a day and a half at the most, to work out how to do it, how to make it, and actually make it. So he was under a tremendous amount of pressure.
The arrow shaft had completely broken off inside the prince's skull. Fortunately, the remaining arrowhead was hollow, and this was to prove a crucial detail.
This extractor has to enter through the wound, locate into the socket of the arrowhead, and the clever part of it is, it expands inside the socket, so it's not going to do any more damage to the future King of England. It grips the arrowhead tight, and then a little bit of a wriggle, and out it comes.
6 centuries after John Bradmore forged his instrument, the Ancient Discoveries team are putting it to the test. Using state-of-the-art virtual technology, they are going to recreate the operation that saved the English prince. The question is, how did the future king survive? July 1403. At Kenilworth Castle, the future King of England lay dying, with an arrow lodged 6 inches inside his skull. How he survived has remained a medical mystery for 6 centuries. At the Ancient Discoveries Test Center, our team are recreating Prince Hal's wound on a pig carcass. Using a 15th century longbow, an arrow is fired at 200 miles per hour into the carcass. Now, top surgeon Mike Edwards is investigating how our extractor can be used to remove the arrowhead.
This is a pig carcass we're dealing with, of course, but we've got to draw some similarities between this and a wound in a human being. This is a big problem to treat because it's in such deep tissue and I can't see the other side of it. What I have to think about is, if I'm going to take out this arrow, what structures are going to be in the way to stop me doing that? Because, especially in the face, there are vital structures that must not be damaged.
Mike's challenge is made more difficult because we know that during surgery, the arrow shaft was broken off, leaving the iron arrowhead deep inside the 6-inch wound.
Now, as you can see, we've taken out the shaft of the arrow, but there's no arrowhead on it. And of course, this must be buried within the wound. Now, John Bradmore knows that there's an arrowhead lodged in there somewhere and he's got to get it out. This is where we test whether or not this implement, made in 1403, is going to be able to take out this arrowhead.
Over 600 years ago, Prince Hal would have had to endure his skull surgery without any form of anesthetic.
The original account says that this wasn't a straightforward procedure. So I'm going to have to be lucky for it to work first time. And it hasn't. I think if I were doing this to Prince Hal right now as John Bradmore, my career would be on the line. Probably my head would be on the line. What I've got to do is just see whether I'm anywhere near the head of the arrow. Ah, I think that's it. Something's engaged. The question is, has it been enough? I'll just tighten the whole thing way down. Oh, joy.
Mike's success came only after much trial and error, and it thus poses a further riddle. How did the prince survive such an invasive procedure? To discover this, the team need the technology of the future to look inside Prince Hal's head. At the Glasgow Digital Design Studio in Scotland, groundbreaking virtual technology may yet crack the riddle of the prince who should never have become king.
What we've done with Prince Hal has built a three-dimensional model, but in layers, if you will. We've started with outside tissues and worked in three-dimensionally. So we've been able to construct the brain, the skull, all the major systems that are inside our head, and actually understand very clearly where the arrowhead was actually lodged.
The team are setting out to model the Prince Hal story in a 3D virtual space. Every real element is modeled to within 1/25th of an inch.
The way that we would build up a realistic 3D image for the arrow or the extractor would be to make the outline of the item. And then what we would use that line to make a set of surfaces. We can then use reference imagery from photographs we've taken, which we can then project onto the surfaces that we've created from those very basic lines, and we end up with what looks like a very realistic end product.
All of the virtual elements are now in place. Neurosurgeon Ian Sabin is about to carry out the first ever virtual operation on a historical figure ever attempted.
We take away the skull and the muscle layer, please.
Okay, we're going into layer selection mode. There you go.
Ian is able to visualize the virtual prince using 3D glasses. Haptic glove technology then allows him to manipulate the prince in a virtual space.
Arrow extractor, please.
Okay, here's the extractor.
The arrow took the only non-fatal trajectory available. It missed the central spinal cord, the brain stem, and the most vital blood vessel in the brain, the carotid artery.
So using Bradmore's extractor, I'm going to pass it along the track that the arrow created, just able to locate it into the socket of the arrowhead, and it appears it's in the right place visually. I can now have a much closer look, which of course Bradmore couldn't do. We can rotate the head and see the tip and then get a really close view. And that's a view that I've certainly never seen before. That's phenomenal. Just missed the carotid artery. He was that close to death.
At this point, 600 years ago, the prince would have been feverish, his heart rate approaching 120 beats per minute. Removing the arrow would have been crucial. But first, Ian must ensure he is correct on the location of the arrowhead.
We're just about to take the arrowhead out. There may be torrential bleeding. We'll need people ready to put pressure on the carotid artery if that happens. Have some packs ready and some vascular clamps. Screw the thread home to open up the jaws so that I can now rock the arrow backwards and forwards, freeing it from its bony entrapment and gradually pulling it back. And out it comes.
The virtual operation has proved a success. The prince has survived.
The injury that Prince Hal received was horrendous. And actually, he was incredibly lucky to survive. But we now can understand, using very advanced technology, how he was able to do that, what the surgeon of the time actually did.
John Bradmore went on to become a celebrated surgeon and was paid 10 sovereigns a year for the rest of his life. These experiments have proved that the ancients' understanding of pain, trauma, and human anatomy was far more advanced than previously thought. Gruesome treatments, from leeches to snakes and torpedoes, should now be seen not as primitive, but visionary. Every hospital visit we make today, every life that is saved, builds on the pioneering groundwork laid by history's first doctors. The secrets of ancient medicine have remained impenetrable for thousands of years. But now they are being rediscovered. Buried within forgotten texts lie accounts of shocking, gruesome treatments. How did Incan surgeons drill through the human skull to save patients from certain death? How did a fish with the power of a taser gun cure pain? An extraordinary surgical tool used to operate on a prince with one of the strangest head wounds in history. Ancient Discoveries is entering a remarkable world of snakes, leeches, and death rays, uncovering a secret. They all worked. This is the untold story of gruesome medicine. Bloodletting. The very word conjures images of cruelty and sacrifice. Beginning over 3,000 years ago, patients were bled to death in their thousands. Ancient doctors removed up to 4 pints in a bid to cure everything from fever to madness.
It does sound outrageous to open the veins and drain somebody of their life-giving fluid, but in some circumstances it can actually be beneficial.
Bloodletting's most famous practitioner hailed from ancient Greece, and his name was Galen. Born in 129 AD, he was to become worshipped as a god for his miraculous healing powers.
Galen had a theory of medicine that was based on balancing humors throughout the body. And he assumed that in order to get the right balance of humors, if you let out blood, then the humors balance themselves.
A chilling array of tools were used to open up his patients, from hooks and scalpels to knives and cutting machines. The most notorious of all was the leech.
I think most patients today, seeing leeches on their body, would throw up their hands in horror, as it being an outmoded form of treatment. But it has undergone a resurgence.
Galen's theories, along with the use of leeches, have been dismissed for centuries. But now, recent evidence has caused medical science to reevaluate them. At the Ancient Discoveries Laboratory, leeches expert Carl Peters is investigating the leeches' blood-sucking powers.
In this small vial here, we have just some ordinary sheep's blood. And on the bottom we have some collagen membrane. So we'll put the leech on the bottom there, and then hopefully it'll drain the vial.
Over 20 minutes, the leech sucks the blood from the vial, multiplying its body weight by up to 4 times. The question remains, how could this phenomenal sucking power be used to save lives? For a window into how ancient leechcraft worked, Ancient Discoveries has brought in a human guinea pig, former military officer David Shaw. Dave is about to feed these miniature carnivores with their food supply for the next 6 months.
I'm not a fan of needles at the best of times, and the leech is like a little biological needle, I suppose, but he's got about 300 teeth, or so they tell me. So yeah, a little bit anxious, a little bit nervous.
Carl attaches the leech to Dave's calf. It begins by flexing to increase body volume and prepare for drinking up to 50 milliliters of human blood. After 25 seconds, the leech breaks the skin.
When it makes the hole, it bites in. It's got three jaws, 125 teeth on each jaw.
Normally, when the skin's surface is broken, a blood clot forms to prevent us from bleeding to death. Here we see the leech's three jaws. Leeches have a unique substance that overrides the body's clotting mechanism, their saliva. This acts as an anticoagulant, which prevents the blood from clotting. In the ancients' procedure, as now, the leech falls off once it's had its fill of approximately 2 ounces of blood.
It was quite an experience. It surprised me the number of times that you actually felt a little sharp prick, and apparently the leech is not happy with just one bite of the cherry. He likes to dig a bit deeper and find the optimum blood supply. You could feel the bodily contractions of the leech as he kind of ingested the blood, but you couldn't feel a flow.
Now begins the second part of the ancient procedure. Most of the blood wasn't removed by the leech itself, but from the unclotted bleeding caused by the leech's saliva.
Once the leech feeds, because of the anticoagulants in the area, it'll sort of help the area decongest, and the hole it makes will still bleed for about 10 hours. So you've got the blood into the artery and out of the hole the leech is made. So it's keeping the area alive long enough for the body to repair.
These limbs are suffering from a septic necrosis, which is caused by a lack of blood supply and bone death, a condition seen on the battlefields of ancient Greece due to sword and axe wounds. As the blood vessels are severed, limbs are deprived of critical nutrients in the blood, resulting in amputation or death. The leech's saliva contains agents that vasodilate the small veins and capillaries in the flesh. This allowed ancient leeches to draw the blood evenly through damaged flesh, keeping it alive while it healed. Yet leeches were not the only skin-crawling critter to inhabit the world of ancient gruesome medicine. The most shocking treatments of all came from poisonous snakes. In Greece lies the ruins of Epidaurus, headquarters of a mysterious ancient snake cult said to have magical healing powers. It was founded in 300 BC by a demigod whose name was Asclepius.
The cult of Asclepius was very important in ancient Greece, and people would flock from all over Europe to visit him and to receive his wisdom and his healing and his diagnostic powers.
Asclepius's symbol of healing was a snake.
There is the fable of the snake bringing the herbs of life, and it is thought that his symbol of the staff with the single snake coiled round it arises from that story.
Asclepius's snake potions were said to have the power to revive the dead. For 2,300 years, they have been dismissed as myth. Now, modern science may provide clues as to how the snake potion worked. The Liverpool School of Tropical Medicine in England houses over 200 of the world's most poisonous snakes. Dr. Rob Harrison is one of the foremost experts on the medical effects of snake venom. In order to make a snake potion, the ancients would have needed to milk the venom. Our subject is the horned viper, one of the most dangerous snakes in the world.
Venom extraction is a dangerous procedure. It should only be done by experts. It's important when I'm helping Paul milking the snakes that we're not scared, but that we feel competent. Anxious is all right, scared is not all right.
The horned viper is native to northern Africa, and just half of its maximum dose is enough to kill an adult.
If a person was bitten, they could be in a life-threatening situation within 20 minutes, half an hour.
Okay, Paul, are you ready? Yeah,
ready.
As Dr. Harrison and his snake handler, Paul, extract the poison, they are replicating a process carried out by the ancient snake handlers.
You got the green one?
I've got the green
one.
Okay,
good. Thanks. Yeah. Ready?
Good.
Once the snake is trapped, the handlers place its jaws over the edge of a beaker and force the venom into the beaker's bottom. Modern research supports the idea that a snake potion would have had certain benefits. The neurotoxins can be used to create drugs that treat Alzheimer's and memory loss, and its hemotoxins help combat heart disease and high blood pressure.
125,000 people die every year from snake bite. High blood pressure certainly kills many more people than that. And the ACE inhibitors, which are the most effective drug against high blood pressure, were developed from snake venom proteins. So we should look at snakes not just as enemies, but also as potential contributors to our better health.
If the ancients did access the same unique properties of snakes as modern medicine, how did they ingest the venom in the first place? Amazingly, they may have drank it. Drinking lethal snake venom is not fatal, unless there are cuts in the digestive system allowing the venom access to the bloodstream. 2,300-year-old accounts tell of Asclepius' patients drinking from the head of a snake-covered gorgon and then developing the power to heal. Tantalizing evidence that the ancient Greeks could have discovered the same healing powers as the 21st century's latest medical drugs. The ancients' unrelenting search for new medical treatments even saw them transform an underwater killer's taser-like weapon into a miracle cure. The secrets had been lost to time. Until now. Since the beginning of history, humans have sought to manipulate and control pain. From ancient torture devices that inflict unimaginable suffering to magical ointments that make pain disappear.
The fact that we want to get rid of pain is not new. I'm sure the Romans, the Greeks, the Egyptians, and probably everybody who went there before them didn't want pain either.
Today, when we think of pain relievers, we think of aspirins or morphine. But in 100 AD, the Romans discovered a very different solution to pain relief. A secret lost to history that depended on a terrifying denizen of the deep. Roman historian Plutarch left an account describing an incredible pain neutralizer, a rare kind of electric eel known as a torpedo.
The ancient Roman sources describe how sufferers of extreme joint and leg pain were taken down to the beach. Here, their feet were placed directly on top of the torpedo. After time, their suffering abated and their pain disappeared.
The Roman accounts tell of how the torpedo could be used to cure almost all pains, from stomach cramps to syphilis. But aside from the basic ancient descriptions, nothing is known about how the treatment actually worked. How does the jolt of a dangerous animal relieve pain? At the Finisterre Aquarium in La Coruña, Spain, torpedoes are being scientifically examined for the first time. Fernanda Miguelis is a marine scientist who has long been fascinated by the fish whose deadly electric shock weapon may have the power to heal.
It's a fish that has remained mysterious for centuries because it primarily lives undercover on sandy beds, hidden from human eyes. The torpedo's electric discharge is primarily for defense, but it is also used to kill prey. When in an attack mode, the torpedo electrocutes its target fish, paralyzing it before swallowing it whole.
To unravel the mysteries of the torpedo, the fish's deadly electric charge must first be quantified using the latest scientific techniques. To do this, the team need to move the torpedo to the laboratory's test center. 2 millennia after the Romans discovered the torpedo's electric powers, modern science can now reveal how the electricity is produced. 2 electric organs, each containing over 1,000 cells, form the torpedo's electrical power station. When the torpedo stings, the brain signals for the cells to fire, and an electrical charge is produced.
Each of the cells produces a small quantity of electricity, but the combination of many cells, all acting in unity, generates an exceptionally powerful electrical...
And the word tonight is UNIVAC, the giant brain made only by Remington Rand. It's the first electronic computing system to be proven by widespread use. Because of its exclusive self-checking features, UNIVAC cannot make a mistake. That's why the United States government, General Electric, U.S. Steel, Metropolitan Life, and DuPont have selected UNIVAC, the world's first electronic computer practical for commercial use. A product of Remington Rand, famous too for the Remington, the world's number one electric taser.
The result is a living aquatic taser.
This machine here is an oscilloscope. We use it to measure the torpedo's electric discharge. It measures the voltage of the charge in relation to time. Today, we are going to measure the highest electric charge that it is possible for the torpedo to produce.
Torpedo is Latin for paralyzed, so Fernanda must take great care when handling the fish during the test. The torpedo fires its electric bolt, which registers at 20 volts, almost twice the shock level from a modern car battery.
Look, look here. There is a signal of 20 volts, firing three times at intervals of only 5 milliseconds. This would cause a severe pain if inflicted upon a person.
The Ancient Discoveries team now have a solid reading of the torpedo's electric potential. But the vital question remains, how did the Romans transform an aquatic taser weapon into an anesthetic? At the Ancient Discoveries Pain Lab, Dr. Watson is about to test how Plutarch's astonishing 2,000-year-old pain reliever actually relieves pain. And for that, we need someone in pain. David Shaw has returned to put his body on the line for another daredevil ancient experiment.
We're going to measure how tolerant Dave is of pain.
Dr. Watson places Dave's finger in a device called an algometer. This will push him to the limit of pain endurance by squeezing his finger until he can bear it no longer.
I'm going to put your finger in here, and I'm going to keep squeezing, and I'm going to keep applying pressure until you tell me to stop. It's going to hurt, so give me a finger. I'm going to start applying the pressure, and I'm going to squeeze and squeeze and squeeze.
As Dr. Watson cranks up the pressure on Dave's finger, neurotransmitters shoot up through the nervous system at 300 feet per second to deliver pain messages to the brain. At this rate, his brain is experiencing pain signals commensurate with a second-degree burn.
Go on, keep going, keep going, keep going. Have you?
A bit more. Ooh, that'll do, that'll do, that'll do.
Well, Dave, that was 827. Well, 827 is not too bad. That's certainly higher than average. And but then, given your background and your exposure to pain in the past, then I'd expect you to be higher than average.
Oh.
Dave's reading reveals he is able to withstand 827 kilopascals of pressure, equivalent to having a 700-pound person standing on his finger.
It's kind of an all-encompassing pain that you can't really escape from. Certainly wouldn't want to be in that kind of pain if it was a continual, just a 24/7. You'd be looking for something, anything, to relieve the pain, especially if it was as intense as I've just experienced.
Now, the way we think the torpedo worked is that it produced enough electrical charge to theoretically numb pain by neutralizing the nerve impulses sending messages to the brain. So Dr. Watson matches the number of volts produced by the torpedo and administers that to our patient.
We're going to be using an electrical stimulator that delivers a particular kind of current. It's really just a modern version of what the Romans were doing with their torpedo fish. Okay, Dave, so what we've done is we put a couple of fairly big electrodes here. I'm just going to turn this up really slowly.
The electrical current is almost identical to the 20-volt reading from the torpedo. If the ancient accounts are correct, in his electrically numbed state, Dave should now be able to increase his pain score of 827 kilopascals.
How it works is this. There's a gate in the spinal cord which controls how much pain does and doesn't get through. We're simply using electricity to make the nerve fire. The stimulation of this nerve is going to shut the pain gate, and effectively we're going to reduce the ability of the body to transmit pain from the hand up to his brain. And if the pain starts in his hand but doesn't reach his brain, he can't feel it, and therefore he will feel less pain.
Now, Dr. Watson must test whether the electrotherapy theory works in practice. After 15 minutes of electrical stimulation at 20 volts, Dr. Watson cranks up the pinometer for the second time. The pinometer crunches Dave's finger into 1/4 inch. He is now experiencing a far greater level of pain than we would expect a human to be able to take.
Yep. Okay. So that gives us 1096. That's
1096.
That's really different from last time. Very different.
200 up.
200 up. That's about 25% up on where we were before. Originally, he was feeling 827. That's when he told me to stop. This time, we got up to 1096 before he told me to stop. So I've made him less able to feel pain.
Dave can now withstand pressure equivalent to being run over by a 2-ton truck. 2,000 years after Plutarch's first accounts, this pioneering experiment has revealed that the stories of the ancient Romans' miracle cure are grounded in fact.
I'm pretty sure they didn't understand about pain gates in the spinal cord, and I'm pretty sure they didn't understand about stimulating nerves in order to get pain relief, but they knew that using electricity, which happened to come from a torpedo fish, produced the sensation of pain relief. Thousands of years later, our modern machines are just an up-to-date way of doing torpedo fish therapy.
Even the Romans might wince at some of the treatments in the mysterious world of the Incas. Here, doctors literally cut open the human head. In Cusco, Peru, in the remote reaches of the Andes, a cache of over 500 Incan skulls has been discovered. Over half bear signs of terrible, seemingly impossible injuries. Circular wounds in the skull up to 3 inches across, too precise to be inflicted by any known weapon. Evidence of an ancient, gruesome practice. Inca historian Peter Frost is investigating the mythical world of the Incas.
The mystery of the Incas comes from the fact that they were a civilization that grew up in isolation from the rest of the world. There wasn't any contact with them, and they didn't have a written language.
The skulls were found in a region known as the Sacred Valley, home to the magnificent lost city of Machu Picchu. Founded in the year 1450, the city lies at almost 8,000 feet above sea level. Surrounded by cliffs and continually wreathed in cloud, this was the secretive citadel of a civilization that ruled over 1 million square miles and 10 million people. Yet the Incas lived here for just 100 years, sucking the mystery of the Incan skulls into the mists of time. 5 centuries later, new forensic evidence may yet solve the riddle. It suggests that the people survived their injuries.
There are lots of examples of skulls that they've unearthed, which show that the skulls began to grow back over the wound.
The linchpins of Incan warfare were weapons such as the club or mace, weapons that deliver severe trauma injuries, such as a fracture to the skull.
The thing about a skull injury or a skull fracture, a depression fracture, is that it pushes bone fragments into the brain area, and they must be elevated or taken away, because of course the skull is a box. And if the box is closed and there's bleeding inside the brain, then pressure increases and eventually the brain must die.
Incan surgeons developed an astonishing solution to this seemingly fatal injury.
They did develop one technique which is extraordinarily sophisticated, which is skull trepanation.
Trepanation is the removal of an area of the skull to release pressure or to decompress a depressed fracture of the skull.
We can tell how long an Inca lived after the procedure by analyzing the skulls to see if they show signs of healing. Amazingly, in 80% of the observed cases, the Incas survived this early form of brain surgery. But how? At the Ancient Discoveries Laboratory, leading surgeon Mike Edwards is taking a journey back through 600 years of history. He is carrying out a trepanation using Incan tools on the head of a dead sheep, purchased from a butcher shop.
The challenges involved in performing a trepanning in Incan times must have been tremendous. Let's imagine that I'm sitting on some Peruvian hillside with this chap's head between my knees, and I've taken the hair away by shaving, and I'm just making my first incision.
Mike will use the same blade as the Incan surgeons, a form of volcanic glass called obsidian, which is 5 times sharper than surgical steel. Keep in mind, the Inca patient would not have been anesthetized.
It's a tense time because I know it's going to hurt the guy that I'm operating on, but yet I have to keep my nerve. I mustn't be put off by his screams, and my hand mustn't shake, and I've got to know what I'm doing is going to benefit him. It's the same for any surgical procedure, apart from the fact, in this case, my patient's wide awake and feeling what I'm doing. The obsidian blade went through the scalp in one fluid move, so it's an incredibly sharp instrument.
It takes Mike about 30 minutes to cut through the bone. Not long, unless you're an Inca patient. During the operation, Mike lacerates several cranial nerves, sending extreme pain messages instantaneously to the brain. Beneath the bone lies the dura, a thin layer embedded with blood vessels. It is the body's final layer protecting the brain, but it has the consistency of a cotton shirt.
I'm very careful as I go through the skull not to damage the dura, because I know if I pierce the dura, it's going to bleed, and I may not be able to control the bleeding. I will also enter the brain tissue. It may be that there's pressure inside the brain that has caused me to be doing this procedure in the first place. So if I pierce the dura, there's every chance that the brain may just burst through like toothpaste and just come out in front of me, and the patient will die within seconds.
Well, looking at this, I think this has been a successful trepanning. We've made the skin flap that you see here. We've gone through the periosteum, we've gone through the bone, and this, peeping up at us through this hole here, is the dura.
The vast majority of patients were killed not by the trepanning, but by infection of the brain afterwards. But 8 out of 10 Incan patients survived. The bone reformed over the hole and the skin healed, leaving nothing behind but a small indentation. In the same time period, over 6,000 miles away in England, a simple blacksmith set about transforming medical history. How did he use nothing more than a hammer and molten metal to perform brain surgery needed to remove an arrow that had been shot straight through the head of the most powerful prince in the medieval world? The ultimate test center for medicine is the theater of war. Yet few today realize that the surgical techniques deployed in war zones from Vietnam to Iraq were invented over 2 millennia ago in Imperial Rome. The Roman drive for military might saw the creation of the Medici, the first medical army elite in history.
The medics became very much more important and significant as the Roman army became professionalized. And this was around the first century AD by Emperor Augustus, who recognized the importance of having a quality medical support team for his forces, for his armies.
Preserved at the Museum of Roman Civilization in Rome lies an intriguing collection of images taken from Trajan's column and dating from the year 113 AD. They depict surgeons operating on the front lines, applying bandages, splints, and emergency first aid. If the reliefs are accurate, they show that the Roman surgeons pioneered the tools and techniques used by today's military medics. Leading surgeon Damien Mole is investigating.
The basic principles behind surgery and surgical operations have changed little throughout the ages, even though the technology has. A battlefield surgeon would be interested in stopping blood or needing to perform an emergency amputation. He would have needed something to cut skin, muscle, tendon, which would be a knife, and he would have needed something to cut bone, which would have been a saw. This saw is still used by many, many operators to cut through bone during an amputation.
An extraordinary account left in a second century text by a Roman surgeon named Celsus describes an early use of scalpels, hooks, and clamps. Amazingly, its instructions are still obeyed in operating theaters today. Modern surgeons clean and stitch up wounds just as he recommended over 1800 years before.
Only a foolish surgeon would ever ignore history and ignore the past. The kind of clamps and that were used in Roman times are similar to the ones used today. There have been developments in the materials and obviously in the design of the clamps, but the principle of applying them and the mechanics used of the instrument to stop blood flow would have almost certainly been identical.
Celsus's four sins of inflammation, redness, heat, pain, and swelling, are still memorized by every modern surgeon. This patient will later make a full recovery, a recovery founded on Rome's battlefield medics. Yet throughout history, survival depends not just on battlefield innovation, but also on rank and influence. The need to save wounded generals, commanders, kings, and even emperors has driven medicine to astonishing new heights. In the year 1403, Prince Hal, heir to the English throne, led 4,000 troops against an uprising that would become known as the Battle of Shrewsbury. He was aged just 16, and within 24 hours, his face would never be the same again.
As the Royal Army advanced, the archers on the top of the hillside sent this hail of arrows down the hill. And contemporaries, when they've experienced a battle like this, all talk about how the sky literally darkens over because of the sheer number of arrows that come flying down through the sky. Now, if you're a knight and you're wearing full plate armor, it gets increasingly difficult to breathe. So as they're staggering up this hillside, the first thing they all do is throw back their visors, and that makes them immediately vulnerable to the arrows because their faces are lifted. And so that's exactly what happened to Henry V.
Prince Hal was struck by an arrow just beneath his left eye. It penetrated 6 inches into the skull, leaving the prince fighting for his life.
The extraordinary thing about Battle of Shrewsbury is not just that Henry V got hit by this arrow, but that he didn't leave. He stayed on and he fought. This wretched arrow stuck in his face.
At the Glasgow Digital Design Studio in Scotland, eminent neurosurgeon Ian Sabin has for the first time recreated this wound on a virtual Prince Hal.
The arrowhead involved was a bodkin, which was designed to be armor-piercing, and as such would have punched its way through the tissues almost surgically. Potentially, structures that were damaged include a nerve that exits just under the eye, called the infraorbital nerve, which gives feeling to the cheek, which would have left him with a numb cheek. It would then have penetrated the thin bone of the maxillary air sinus, which is an air-filled cavity within the skull, and punched its way through the nose before ending up in this area, close to the jawbone or mandible, and very close to the carotid arteries.
At a scale of over 1,000%, Ian is now able to map in three dimensions how perilously close the prince came to death.
So if we now remove the facial skeleton to show the arrow track more clearly, we can see just how close potentially it came to structures that would have led to fairly rapid death. The jugular vein, the main draining vein from the brain, and the carotid arteries, the main arteries leading to the brain and to the facial muscles. In addition, very close also is the spinal cord and the brainstem, injury to which would have been instantly fatal.
The prince was taken to Kenilworth Castle in the heart of England. Its ghostly remains still stand, His attendants carefully tried to remove the arrow, but then, disaster. The arrow breaks. Now the prince has a bodkin arrowhead lodged 6 inches inside his skull. How will they get it out? And who in all the kingdom has the skill to do it? The prince's advisors chose John Bradmore, a surgeon, locksmith, and convicted coin forger, for the challenge of a lifetime.
You've got to imagine that Bradmore was in a unique situation. For the start, that he was in prison for counterfeiting, which was quite a serious offence, and he had been dragged out of prison, brought up to Kenilworth and said, right, here's the situation, you've got the future King of England, he's got an arrowhead in his head, we want you to get it out.
Just hours out of prison, John Bradmore hatched an incredible plan. He decided to forge a new surgical instrument armed with nothing but a hammer and several sheets of molten metal. Historical blacksmith Hector Cole is reconstructing John Bradmore's arrow extractor using the same techniques Bradmore himself would have used over 600 years earlier.
What John Bradmore would have had to have done first would to forge out the strip of metal to make the main body of the extractor. And I've done that, and I've thinned out the two ends so that they are the right thickness to be able to put the flutes in, to make it into a half a cylinder at each end. Because when the two come together, they make a complete tube to enter the wound where the arrow went into Prince Henry's head.
While John Bradmore worked, hour by hour, fever and infection pushed the prince ever closer to death.
Time was of the essence, obviously, and he didn't have a lot of time to make it. He would have had perhaps a day and a half at the most, to work out how to do it, how to make it, and actually make it. So he was under a tremendous amount of pressure.
The arrow shaft had completely broken off inside the prince's skull. Fortunately, the remaining arrowhead was hollow, and this was to prove a crucial detail.
This extractor has to enter through the wound, locate into the socket of the arrowhead, and the clever part of it is, it expands inside the socket, so it's not going to do any more damage to the future King of England. It grips the arrowhead tight, and then a little bit of a wriggle, and out it comes.
6 centuries after John Bradmore forged his instrument, the Ancient Discoveries team are putting it to the test. Using state-of-the-art virtual technology, they are going to recreate the operation that saved the English prince. The question is, how did the future king survive? July 1403. At Kenilworth Castle, the future King of England lay dying, with an arrow lodged 6 inches inside his skull. How he survived has remained a medical mystery for 6 centuries. At the Ancient Discoveries Test Center, our team are recreating Prince Hal's wound on a pig carcass. Using a 15th century longbow, an arrow is fired at 200 miles per hour into the carcass. Now, top surgeon Mike Edwards is investigating how our extractor can be used to remove the arrowhead.
This is a pig carcass we're dealing with, of course, but we've got to draw some similarities between this and a wound in a human being. This is a big problem to treat because it's in such deep tissue and I can't see the other side of it. What I have to think about is, if I'm going to take out this arrow, what structures are going to be in the way to stop me doing that? Because, especially in the face, there are vital structures that must not be damaged.
Mike's challenge is made more difficult because we know that during surgery, the arrow shaft was broken off, leaving the iron arrowhead deep inside the 6-inch wound.
Now, as you can see, we've taken out the shaft of the arrow, but there's no arrowhead on it. And of course, this must be buried within the wound. Now, John Bradmore knows that there's an arrowhead lodged in there somewhere, and he's got to get it out. This is where we test whether or not this implement, made in 1403, is going to be able to take out this arrowhead.
Over 600 years ago, Prince Hal would have had to endure his skull surgery without any form of anesthetic.
The original account says that this wasn't a straightforward procedure. So I'm going to have to be lucky for it to work first time. And it hasn't. I think if I were doing this to Prince Hal right now as John Bradmore, my career would be on the line. Probably my head would be on the line. What I've got to do is just see whether I'm anywhere near the head of the arrow. Ah, I think that's it. Something's engaged. The question is, has it been enough? I'll just tighten the whole thing way down. Oh, joy.
Mike's success came only after much trial and error, and it thus poses a further riddle. How did the prince survive such an invasive procedure? To discover this, the team need the technology of the future to look inside Prince Hal's head. At the Glasgow Digital Design Studio in Scotland, groundbreaking virtual technology may yet crack the riddle of the prince who should never have become king.
What we've done with Prince Hal has built a three-dimensional model, but in layers, if you will. We've started with outside tissues and worked in three-dimensionally. So we've been able to construct the brain, the skull, all the major systems that are inside our head, and actually understand very clearly where the arrowhead was actually lodged.
The team are setting out to model the Prince Hal story in a 3D virtual space. Every real element is modeled to within 1/25th of an inch.
The way that we would build up a realistic 3D image for the arrow or the extractor would be to make the outline of the item, and then what we would use that line to make a set of surfaces. We can then use reference imagery from photographs we've taken, which we can then project onto the surfaces that we've created from those very basic lines, and we end up with what looks like a very realistic end product.
All of the virtual elements are now in place. Neurosurgeon Ian Sabin is about to carry out the first ever virtual operation on a historical figure ever attempted.
We take away the skull and the muscle layer, please. Okay, we're going into layer selection mode. There you go.
Ian is able to visualize the virtual prince using 3D glasses. Haptic glove technology then allows him to manipulate the prince in a virtual space.
Arrow extractor, please. Okay, here's the extractor.
The arrow took the only non-fatal trajectory available. It missed the central spinal cord, the brain stem, and the most vital blood vessel in the brain, the carotid artery.
So using Bradmore's extractor, I'm going to pass it along the track that the arrow created, just able to locate it into the socket of the arrowhead, and it appears it's in the right place visually. I can now have a much closer look, which of course Bradmore couldn't do. We can rotate the head and see the tip, and then get a really close view. And that's a view that I've certainly never seen before. That's phenomenal. Just missed the carotid artery. He was that close to death.
At this point, 600 years ago, the prince would have been feverish, his heart rate approaching 120 beats per minute. Removing the arrow would have been crucial. But first, Ian must ensure he is correct on the location of the arrowhead.
We're just about to take the arrowhead out. There may be torrential bleeding. We'll need people ready to put pressure on the carotid artery if that happens. Have some packs ready and some vascular clamps. Screw the thread home to open up the jaws so that I can now rock the arrow backwards and forwards, freeing it from its bony entrapment and gradually pulling it back. And out it comes.
The virtual operation has proved a success. The prince has survived.
The injury that Prince Hal received was horrendous. And actually, he was incredibly lucky to survive. But we now can understand, using very advanced technology, how he was able to do that, what the surgeon of the time actually did.
John Bradmore went on to become a celebrated surgeon and was paid 10 sovereigns a year for the rest of his life. These experiments have proved that the ancients' understanding of pain, trauma, and human anatomy was far more advanced than previously thought. Gruesome treatments, from leeches to snakes and torpedoes, should now be seen not as primitive, but visionary. Every hospital visit we make today, every life that is saved, builds on the pioneering groundwork laid by history's first.